Well, bienvenidos.
Muchas gracias.
It's great to see you. I interviewed you quite a few years ago for Valentine's Day. I don't know if you remember or not.
I do remember it.
We did a lot.
How have you been? I see you're well.
I'm well. I'm healthy. You know, I actually didn't gain weight in COVID. You know.
Good.
Yeah, I'm just trying to stay happy and alive, you know.
Yes.
So I had to reach out because this is just so exciting, your 60th anniversary, you know, and I think I told you last time, I grew up with Romeros in my house. You know, if we were having a fancy dinner party, you know, we had flamenco music on and it was Los Romeros, you know, I would dance in the living room, you know.
Great. I hope you got that on Sunday.
I certainly will. I'm really excited about the concert. It's your first virtual live concert, right?
Yes, of the quartet. Yeah. I've done solo ones, but the quartet is the first one.
Wow. I'm very excited to hear what you guys are. Can you tell us a few cuts of what you're going to be playing?
Yes, of course. We decided that to celebrate the 60th anniversary that we will play some of our biggest hits.
Awesome. Will that include some of the classical titles too?
Yes, it will. It will be some of Pretoria's dances and Vivaldi.
Oh, I love that.
And Boccherini, and then a lot of Spanish like Manuel de Falla and Albéniz, Granados,
Rodrigo,
my father. Compositions by my father, and we'll end with a flamenco improvisation.
Wow. Okay. All right. Wow. Well, I won't even wonder what the encores are going to be. How exciting. I'm really thrilled because, you know, I haven't been able to go to any kind of guitar concert at anything of the time, and there's nothing more intense, you know, acoustically than a great guitar concert, you know.
It is. Chopin said there is nothing better than one guitar. And this was Frederick Chopin. He said, there's nothing better than one guitar except two guitars.
That's awesome.
And I wonder what he would have said with four.
He probably would have been thrilled, if not scared. He might have been a little scared. Because it is awesome. And it's and you know, 60 years of a family touring together and actually coming out of Spain, right? Because, you know, I know you guys came away to get away from Franco, you know.
And exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
I mean, and I don't know if people today understand that my mother and I lived in Franco, Spain for a few years in the early 70s, and it was oppressive.
Very oppressive. And in the 70s, the eyes of the world were upon Spain, so he eased up a lot.
Wow.
But we actually went back to Spain to perform in January of 1970. My brother Angel and I, we did the Spanish premiere of Concierto Madrigal by Rodrigo, and then a year later the quartet performed there. Still when Franco was alive. And I was playing a recital in Madrid when he died in 1975.
Wow. Were you concerned that they might try to, you know, seize you or keep you?
No, we went back as American citizens.
Protected.
Yes.
Awesome. Well, I mean, as tragic as having to leave your home is and come to the United States from that kind of oppression, because it's very sad, but it did so much for us because the Romeros were born, right?
Yes, and you know, it did a lot for us, because the experience of arriving in California, we went to Santa Barbara, and the freedom, the wonderful feeling that in 1957, the cars, the lifestyle in the United States, and the welcoming feeling that we got from the American people, from friends, and then later from audience and public, it opened up a new horizon. And I feel very, very much a part of both countries.
Beautiful. Well, and it is when you're welcomed that way, right? And yes, Santa Barbara, the ocean. I mean, I've been to Santa Barbara many times. It's one of my favorite places just to look because it's so gorgeous.
Yes, exactly. And to be able to speak freely without fearing that you were going to say the wrong thing and perhaps end up executed.
Yeah.
Was happening in Spain to the people who were not on Franco's side. And there were so many eyes upon the artists, the people who believed in liberty, and those who did not join the regime of Franco.
Right, right. The dissenters, the evil ones.
Yes.
It's so scary that some of that, you know, taste of today. But I believe in the people. I think our love for music and each other will rise above all that kind of stuff, because it never works.
It does. And even remembering back in the days of Spain, I personally grew up in seeing the benefits of music, the healing power of music to human suffering.
Yeah.
It's really amazing. And my house in Spain was a center for intellectuals, artists, painters, and people who believed in music, in art, in literature, and very much in the liberty of the human mind and the artistic expression and the expression of one's feelings.
Wow, that's a beautiful thing. You know, my mother and I were just kind of arguing a little bit about passion, because in today's world, passion is something that people call you out for. If you have a passion, they go, oh, well, you're a this or you're a that.
Oh, yes.
But I believe, and she does too, that our passion is what leads us, right? I mean, what else could lead a family from Malaga, Spain, under Franco, to come to the United States and then become this performing troupe beloved by the world? You know?
Well, what does is the gift of music and the necessity to share it. Because with the gift of music and art comes the will to share it, to let other people join in something that you love. A piece of music is not finished until the listener, the one who finished the piece, is the audience.
Yeah, that's right. They take it in, you know.
They take it in.
Yeah.
And thus the work is done.
That's right. Beautiful. When you know, looking back now 60 years, you know, and thinking of this anniversary, you know, I mean, you made your debut at 16, right?
No.
No.
I made my debut at 7.
At 7? Oh, wow.
I made debut in Spain, in Sevilla, in a concert, in a joint concert with my father. And that was playing solo. So actually, I am celebrating my 70th anniversary of playing on the stage.
Wow.
Solo. But the quartet was in 1961. And in 1961, I was 16. Yes, I was 16. And it was in Los Angeles. And that was the beginning of the quartet.
But you had already played solo. You had already made that relationship.
I had played solo. And I had also played solo in California, in Santa Barbara.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you have your own albums as well.
Yes, and my father also, I made my first album when I was 15. And so each of us had played solo, but that the concert in Los Angeles in January 20 of 1961, that was the first time that the Los Romeros played as a family, playing solos and then together, joining together to form the guitar quartet, because to my knowledge, there was never a real is the guitar quartet as a genre. And right. We have seen it. We have seen it develop where it's taught in all universities and conservatories all over the world, a big repertoire in these 60 years. Yeah. Have been written for the guitar quartet.
Yeah, well, Rodrigo, right? He has so many works that he wrote specifically for you guys with
Rodrigo. Yeah, Rodrigo wrote for us, and Torroba, Medina, Morton Gould, the great American composer also. Yeah. So when we started, it was just improvising. In 1961, we began by improvising a piece of my father that was for one guitar, and we all sat and improvised, and we turned it into a quartet. And immediately after, it was taken with such enthusiasm by the public and the critics that we immediately set forth to make transcriptions of great works, the Telemann concertos, the pieces by Bach, a lot of Vivaldi, a lot of Baroque music, and then also Spanish music, yeah, from zarzuelas, from orchestral scores like El Amor Brujo and things like of that type.
And those were the albums I had.
And right away, we started with commissioning composers to write for us. And we have kept it to this day, writing, having music written for us. And later, many of our students developed their own guitar quartets. Four of my students at the University of Southern California started the USC Quartet under my tutelage, and then they became the Los Angeles Guitar Quartet.
I've heard them. Yep.
And themselves have many works written for them and many other quartets all over the world. So it's an immense pleasure to see the fruits of your own work and to continue in the, on the concert stage, performing with your family.
It's got to be awesome. It really must. I've been asking a lot of people this question lately, because do you feel feelings that you felt when you were young come back with certain pieces and certain movements, or even just some of the fingering? Do you remember back when you first learned it, or have a moment when you triumphed over a piece that just, yes, all of a sudden, yes, comes back?
Yes, of course, of course. And that is one of the greatest pleasures for me, is how music make you travel in time.
Yeah.
In either in your own lifetime or into the minds and the feelings of the composers who have for so long been gone.
Yeah.
And whatever they felt when they wrote it comes alive.
Yeah.
And yes, and with playing a piece that one have played when you were young, and now you are in your 70s, and all of a sudden a light bulb goes on and you finally understand it. Not that you thought that you didn't, but it begins to to show itself, the music shows itself to the musician in different ways.
Yeah.
And there are pieces of music that accompany us throughout our life.
Yeah.
That's like a good friend.
Like a good friend, yeah. Well, that's, I think that's, if you make friends, then it's your friend for your whole life, right?
That's right, that's right.
Well, that's go ahead, I'm sorry.
And when you are with a good friend, maybe you are saying kind of the same things and you're sharing your conversation and you're sharing your lives and your feeling and you're talking to your friend, but every time that you see a dear friend is a new growth of that love and that friendship and that feeling. And that happens with a great piece of music. I cannot tell you how many times I have played, for example, Rodrigo Concierto de Aranjuez. How many times the quartet has played the first concerto that we had written for us, Concierto Andaluz, also by Rodrigo. Every time it grows, it deepens, and it shows itself in a more beautiful and fulfilling way.
Yeah, wow, that's fantastic, truly fantastic. You answered my question so perfectly because I've really been wrestling with this because, you know, I was an opera singer at one time and, you know, I get a good day and I just feel like singing and I go ahead and sing and I get that feeling. It's like, oh, this is how you negotiate this note. This is how the diminuendo is supposed to be, right?
Yes.
To me, figuring that out is almost better than going out and performing for a bunch of people.
Yes.
But you always did your learning on stage, right?
Well, I'm always trying to learn. And I, this year, where we have been very much in a lockdown.
Oh, yes.
I personally began the pandemic in Granada, in Spain, and I was there for since the end of February until August, and then I came back to the United States, and I've been in California, and have done several streaming concerts from Granada, from the Alhambra, but that was by myself, and now we set forth to do this streaming concert, but I've had so much time, and I have spent it with the guitar and with music.
Wow.
And I've never practiced more, except when I was a young boy, as I have this year.
Wow.
I've had three periods in my life when I was very young, before I started playing concerts, when I was playing for my own fulfillment and my own joy of music. Then the year my father got ill and canceled almost all my performances, and the quartet also canceled most of our performances that year. And we spent next to my father playing music all day long. And he played until very, very close to the end.
Wow.
So, and now the pandemic. And where you play music just for, music can do a miracle even when no one is listening.
Yeah. That's what it brings in you.
Yes. We, my family and I, feel that in difficult times, the pandemic, the civil war in Spain, if musicians need to play music, even if only they are listening, but every note that you make goes on. It just travels away from you, but it keeps living, I believe, forever.
I believe that.
Because once you make a sound, it changes it becomes part of that eternal vibration.
Yes,
and a sound may be inaudible, but it's still, once you alter a vibration, is going forever. And I think that the more people that play music with a loving heart and with the gratitude for music itself, it makes the world better. I think music is very, very powerful and very important.
I believe it will save us. I really do.
Yes.
I really do. Well, I'm so excited for your concert. I you must be excited too. Are you going to blow up?
Maybe.
Will there be?
You know, this concert is going to take place in a venue that is, I believe, is the first time that they are having classical music.
Oh, wow. Which venue is it?
The venue for Sunday streaming is the Belly Up. It's a jazz club in Solana Beach. And we kind of wanted to make it a party.
Yes. Awesome. So we should bring our wine.
Bring your wine. Set yourself in front of the TV or the computer or however you are going to listen to it. Get yourself a glass of wine, relax, and have a party with us.
Oh my gosh. Well, I'll be there for sure. I got to figure out my wine though. Should I get a Spanish wine or whatever?
Of course. Most of the country is going to be Spanish. So a good Rioja or a good Ribera del Duero or a good Tempranillo, it would be good.
Awesome. Well, you all heard it here. So we got to get our drink on and some wonderful, wonderful Romeros. This is great. Pepe, thank you so much for your time, Maestro. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very, very much. And I look forward to seeing you in person like the last time.
Yeah, that would be awesome, wouldn't it?
Good. Yes, let's keep our fingers crossed.
Absolutely.
All the best to you.
To you too. Thank you.